Good evening. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah. I will not talk about Cricket for at all today. I'll be only talking about this current venture, which is Kizhakku Pathippagam, but I'll be introducing another brand, which is in the same company, also called Dial for Books. Can you just go to the presentation? No, the first page. Because one of the first thing that I have to show is the logo. And you have to, in no other page I'm going to show you any picture, but these two logos are quite important to me, Kizhakku Pathippagam and Dial for Books, and I'll give you the entire story of how we went about building this particular brand. Okay, next. Before we even get into this entire story, we have to start from where we began. The publishing environment. I don't know how familiar you are with the Tamil publishing environment. We started around 2004, and you know, we were quite how shall I say, quite arrogant, in that we thought we knew everything about the field that we were getting into. I had done about maybe 3 months of research. I am a book reader. I read books very regularly. But reading books is different from understanding the publishing environment, right? But for some reason, you know, we had this great feeling that, you know, we knew everything there was to know about that particular area. Then we wrote a business plan. I still have the business plan, and we have multiple revisions of it, and I have copies of all of that. So that particular business plan made a lot of interesting assumptions, right, about the field, about the kind of impact we were going to make, and we were wrong on almost every single thing. Basically, what I'm saying is we didn't have a clue when we entered the business, right? But we did have one idea clear. We wanted to do something really big. Have we done that? No, we have not done that. But the starting point was that we wanted to be in 10 languages, including English. Tamil was where we started, and the idea was that we'll start with Tamil. Very quickly we will cover all the South Indian languages, then we'll get into Hindi and a whole bunch of other languages, Gujarati, Marathi, Punjabi, Bengali, you know, 10 languages that would cover about 80 to 90% of the population. We were entirely wrong. It's not like setting up a mobile phone company. Like Airtel starts with Delhi. No, they are there everywhere, all over India and in various African countries. No, it's not the same in this particular field, in the field of publishing. Now, each market is very different and distinct. Now, it's very difficult for me to run English publishing in the same platform. We did and failed. We started after Tamil, Malayalam and English publishing, and we flopped big time in those. We cut down, and we are now restricted only to Tamil. And I'll talk about why and how different each market is and how you have to really understand a particular market to do well in that market. Okay. So what were the challenges that we were facing? Right. The biggest challenge was, and it remains even today, is that a nation of 1.25 billion, We don't read at all. Today, the biggest reading is probably Facebook. That's what people read, right? You know, would you have really imagined, like, little countries with population of the size of, you know, just that of Chennai. Australia's population is probably that of Chennai plus Mumbai put together, I think. And they read more books. So, in a sense, we are not a nation of book readers. We are split across multiple languages and quite distinctly different cultures. It's very difficult to make one book succeed in every one of these markets. Right? I mean, why, I don't know. I mean, we have to really analyze that. we learnt that. I mean, we many a time we pick up books for translation, we translate, and they may not do well at all. Because it's a book written in, let's say, Hindi, which is doing very well in the Hindi markets. There is no guarantee that that book, when translated into Tamil and presented to the audience, assuming that the translation quality is fantastic, there is no guarantee that it will do well. Okay? So there are many challenges, one of which is the most important challenge is your audience base itself. Right? Then the assumptions. This is what every startup guy starts with, a set of assumptions. And our assumptions are all on Excel sheets. Right? If I sell one book, I'll make 20 rupees profit. So if I have to make 1 crore profit, just work back, I have to sell so many copies. And then you'll work and say, okay, if I have to sell so many copies, how many titles do I put out? Each title selling, say, 10,000 copies, and your Excel sheet is perfect. But what about the reality? Can you really sell these books, these many books, these many titles? Will people buy your books? I have a colleague here. Now, I wasn't expecting anybody. I didn't tell anyone that I was, other than the Facebook and Twitter promotions. And Manivanan here is our head of sales. So he knows all the mistakes that we have made. In, you know, again, it's because you make some assumptions about your potential audience, and then you are trying to, appeal to them, and in the process you make mistakes, and it just doesn't work. Now I'll talk about some of those mistakes. So you spend a few years, make mistakes which are very expensive, and then you come to some conclusions. You started with some assumptions, you made a lot of mistakes, and then you have to decide, what do I do now? Do I do more mistakes? Or you say, okay, I'm going to stop making mistakes, and then I'm going to focus only on certain areas. So this is the story that I'm going to talk about. And along the way, I'll give you a lot of examples. Yeah. So you make some decisions. So first assumption that I told you that we made was that we were going to be in 10 languages. The mistake was that we assumed India is a single country, and that sitting in one corner, you can plan for the entire country. And you can say, I am going to publish a book in these many languages, written by this person, and pushed across to all those markets. Okay. The other thing is that if you put a lot of money behind your idea and then keep on printing books, you'll have to eventually sell. Now, what was the reality? If you look at the, take just Tamil alone, and you want to sell books, you can either sell books directly or you sell books through bookshops. How many bookshops are there in the state? A certain numbers. Are these bookshops growing? Are we going to have more and more bookshops opening up every day? No, they are not. In fact, in the last 14 years or so that we have been there in the business, we have hardly seen new bookshops coming up. But of course, there are major paradigm changes. There is a ebook platform. I mean, when we started, Amazon was not selling in this country, and there was no Flipkart. They were about to emerge in the coming years. But you have them now. But are they replacements for hundreds of bookshops? No. We know we are selling, and we know how many copies we are selling through that platform. Not today. Maybe eventually. Right? We are selling ebooks. But, what are the numbers? So, in terms of the assumptions that we make and the speed with which we want certain things to change, they just don't change at all. Okay. So what were the decisions that we had to make? First, we had to answer this. What do we mean by brand? The first question is that the point that Hari mentioned is that we build businesses. We don't build brands. Not easily in India. I mean, people build businesses. Businesses may actually even do very well. But have we built brands? How many brands have we built? To understand that, you have to first of all describe it a little bit further. What does it mean to build a brand in Tamil publishing? It took us some time to understand it, or so I believe. Let's see that. Okay. So the first thing that we figured out was, we initially assumed that we come up with great books, that's great brand. But actually in Tamil publishing, probably in publishing space, it is actually longevity. Now, you will be surprised, in internet, brands are created in less than a year. Word of mouth spread through Twitter retweets and shares in Facebook, the brand is well known to everyone, but not in the print publishing world. In the first 3 years of our existence, we must have published about 200 plus titles together in 3 years' time. And in the book fairs, which is where you get all the readers come there, a large percentage of them had not even heard of us. We probably had published more titles in those 3 years than many publishing houses in their 20 years time frame. Yet, nobody had known us. So, we'll have a conversation and I will say that I'm a publisher, and they'll say, oh, okay, but what is your name? Say, we are Kizhakku Pathippagam. But I have not heard of you. I have not read any of your books. Then how would you become a brand? Today, after 14 years, if for the next 3 years I don't publish a single new title, I'll still be remembered. Because I have survived for 14 years. But this was a first understanding that we had to get. That we have to survive. Fine. Survival is actually time period. What do you do then year after year? Because survival is not just you know, put up a board and just sit there, right? So then we took, go back, that we'll just have that single line. Yeah, we'll stay here. So the next thing is that this is where we decided that we will survive, we have to survive, but what more? So we chose this concept of completeness. What does it mean? There were plenty of publishing houses. I was sort of divided on ideological lines or areas that they would publish books on. There were left-leaning publishing houses, Islamic publishing houses, religious publishing houses in general, party-driven publishing houses, literary publishing houses. We decided that we will publish everything and we will go and find genre which nobody had published, and we will bring out books, and we will eventually create this mirage. It's not a reality. Brand is not about reality. It's about perception that your customer has, right? That if a book in a particular topic is what I want, I should go to this publishing house and ask for it. There is no way I can publish books on every conceivable topic. But I must create this image that I am publishing a book in every conceivable topic. Hope you understand. There is no way I can publish a book on every topic. But I have to somehow ensure that the customer first thinks of Kizhakku Pathippagam if he is looking for a book in any topic. This happens now. There are many areas that we don't have any book on. But people come and say, like, you know, somebody told me that if you go to Kizhakku Pathippagam, you will get a book in this topic. Now, I'm very happy. So, there is no way I'm fulfilling the expectations of the customer. But I have created the image that I have a phenomenal range. Okay. Then we focused on quality. When we started publishing, and those of you who are older and have been looking at books over the last 2 decades. Tamil publishing was, you know, the quality of books were quite bad. I'll go a little bit into the technicalities. The process of bookmaking is fairly simple. Okay. Assume that you have everything ready in a print ready format. When we started, it's 14 years back, it was the process that was available at that time was that you created a photo negative. So the, you know, the entire form or 16 pages were arranged in a particular order and a photo negative was made, right? Now this photo negative was used to create a plate. This plate was placed in an offset printing machine and a certain number of copies were made. Then that's folded. Then similarly, multiple forms are folded, gathered together, bound, edges cut and delivered. I'm making it fairly simple, but the process of printing the inner pages of the book in a single color, mostly black, is different from printing the outer cover, which is normally in 4 color. Okay. That wrapper should also be laminated, because the lamination is the one that actually holds the quality. Lamination is putting a very, very thin plastic film on top of the printed cardboard. And there has to be a binding process and it has to stick. You take any of the old book and just use your nails, you can actually peel off the lamination. The typical Tamil book at that time, typical, because there could also be, you know, certain other publishers who publish it slightly differently, but the typical book would be a crown sized one. If you don't know the sizes, forget it. It will be glossy laminated. The artwork on the cover will be mostly hand drawn with very limited computer inputs into that. It will use a fairly low quality material for the wrapper, because the printers available here and the binders, etc., that was the only thing that they were doing. The inner pages will use certain standard fonts packed together, because giving spacing meant you had to actually use more pages and it costs money and you want to keep the cost low. So there was no differentiation whatsoever. So some of the first few things that we did is that we introduced totally different spacing inside, larger font, better margins. All these things will look trivial to you, okay? But, you know, we clearly focused on it right from our very first book. The choice of the paper, the way the wrapper images should be designed, how we come up with titles. We want the titles to be really catchy. I can give a fairly boring title or I can make it very exciting. I can come up with a lot of examples, but I'm not really going to go into that, because my idea is to tell you that we started focusing on quality, but things that are under my control, I can do it well. But the printing is going to be done by somebody. So we had to work with them. You know, imagine that we are in our first year. We are a tiny player in the business. But here we were fighting with the printers to produce it to a certain quality. We chose matte lamination uniformly. We chose a certain type of paper for consistency. We changed the size to a Demae 1x8 size. There were other people who were also doing that, but predominantly the books were in crown. So we made all these changes and ensured that the writing was also easy to read. If I can give you an example, it should be as easily readable as Ponniyin Selvan, which is a very, very popular historical novel that Kalki wrote. And people who start reading that, it's 5 volume, maybe 2,500 pages, you can't put the book down. So any book that we come up with, so it's not just in the form, but also the content should be very enjoyable. The pleasure of reading should be brought out. Now, how do you do that? We have writers writing the book, but how do you ensure that the writing quality is of a certain level, that it is really enjoyable to read? So we had to put together an editorial team that will do that value addition. The editorial team will work on the script until it becomes enjoyable to read. Now, for this we have to convince the writers to play along with us. So we can't have an author saying, you know, I will give you my script but you can't edit it. Now, if that's what they say, then we can't publish it. It's as simple as that. So our intention of editing is not to change their idea, but change the manner in which it reads. Now, if their writing is already enjoyable to read, we have nothing to add to that. But if it is not, we will do whatever it takes to make it readable. Now, all our books that we brought out in the first few years and what we are continuing to do have gone through that kind of editing. Make it really enjoyable to read. So that was the basic point that we were giving. And everything else was going along with it. The spacing that we give, the line spacing that we give, the character spacing that we give should also add to reading enjoyability. So we worked on that. And then we come to the final point. Fine, I do all these things. But if I can't make the books available, all the effort has gone waste. Now, I'll talk about how this happens. So, briefly to each. So, longevity is to survive. I have to somehow survive. Next. So, build a range, which I already told you. Quality, I've also explained to you how within the constraints that we had to work towards building this quality. Now, we come to the last point. Okay. Having produced this book, what do I do? The first few months, the first year and a half spent in getting the book out to every single shop that was out there. That was not that difficult. That was not that difficult for Tamil. I'll briefly talk about Malayalam and English later. We could go from Chennai to Coimbatore to Salem to Kanyakumari, cover every bookshop, give books to them. They were more than happy to get the books and list them. And as they were selling, they reordered. Collecting money from them was difficult, but that's okay. I mean, we'll get around to that. But they were more than happy to list the books. But after we counted everything, we were hardly in about 200 shops. What do we do now? That's not enough. You can't build a brand with presence in 200 shops. But that's what every single publisher was doing. So we decided, no, that was not going to be the case for us. Either we are like any other publisher, in which case there was no point in building a business at all, or we had to be different. So we completely changed our model. We will be there in every bookshop, but we'll go beyond that. And then that is how we put together our distribution model. And one of the architects is sitting here, so I'll introduce him towards the end, Manivannan. So we had more members in the team, and we started building other ways in which we could get the book out. If people are not going to come to bookshops, we have to take the books to where the people were, or where the people are. So we identified restaurants, textile shops, supermarkets, and any corner shop, including tea shops along the way. And later on, when these highways started coming up, and we had all these Only Coffee or Kumbakonam Coffee or whatever you call them, all those shops. And it was a huge battle. First, we had one eatery somewhere near Namakkal, I think, which agreed to actually have our books. It was a novelty. Nobody would sell a book in a restaurant. So we made some racks, and we put them up, and you won't believe, we were selling, in terms of volumes, in terms of the money that we were making, more money from that shop than from many of the established bookshops. Because people were going to a restaurant to eat, and when they saw a good book, they were happy to pick them up. But not, I mean, there are very few people who actually go to a bookshop. See, it's not that I'm dissing bookshops. You know, they still give me a considerable revenue. But if those are the only shops that I depended on, you know, I wouldn't have progressed at all, right? So we started going to all these shops. Now, how do we get our books there? Bookshops will place an order, because the bookshop is managed by a person who knows what books are. Restaurants are managed by people who have no clue about books. Textile shops, by the way, why do we go to textile shops? Not that I want to be sexist, but typically what happens in a textile shop is that women spend hours looking at saris, and men who accompany have nothing else to do, and we wanted to actually show the books to them. By the way, books are predominantly bought by men, sadly. It should be bought by everyone, but men are the ones who actually buy more books, and we don't know exactly how we can change this. That's for later. So that's how we had textile shops, and supermarkets are like easy. People go there, pick up a bunch of things, and along the way, if they find a book interesting, they should buy that. So we have identified places, but we have to take books there, and all these guys have no idea about how to order books. So we built a complete distribution setup, by which we are talking about figuring out who is already doing some kind of distribution of something, namely the FMCG distributors, who are actually distributing maybe some food products, biscuits, cigarettes, cooking oil, all kinds of products in a specific region, who already has a relationship with some of these shops, has a vehicle and delivery boys. So we then, our team started contacting people in these areas and started converting them also to book distribution. So over time we built a very interesting FMCG-like book distribution model. Now, to manage this book distribution, we had to build a sales team. So it's all like, you know, bottom up. So how do we build a sales team? We again had different regions, we had regional sales managers, we had sales territory supervisors, and then we had to, now that you have a team, you have to make them sell. So you have to give them targets, and if you give them targets, they'll come back and ask, so where is the product? So I can't have the same 10 books every month. So I need to have more and more books. So we had to build a huge editorial team. Then that's not enough, because they can only edit. So who will write? So we had to get hold of a lot of writers and even people who were not writers and convince them to write books on things that we thought would sell and things that the writers believed would sell. So get them, make them write, produce. So we were actually running it like a factory. We had targets. Every month, 8 books should be out. Then we started creating more brands. I'm rushing through because we need to talk a little bit more. Then we created multiple imprint brands. We had created children's books. There will be like 16 books or 8 books every month in this particular area, 8 books in that area, 8 books here. So there will be an army of people who will type, who will edit, who will correct, they will all be sent for printing. And then you'll have to also deal with reprints. And you have to distribute. And when we did all of this, at the end of the day, we found that we were losing money, big time. Because to just feed this mega machinery, you have to keep on throwing more money into the system. That was simply unworkable. So we had to change track again. See? Next one. So this also I told you, so I'm going beyond that. So, okay, go back. So I have to tell you a lot more at this point. So we found that we were actually spending a lot of money And we were building really a wonderful brand, but that was not enough. So at some point in time, we took stock of the situation and changed. What was actually helping us increase our visibility was also something that was hurting. But by then, fortunately, we had put in enough time so that longevity part had come. Visibility was already there. Brand had been built. Now we had to really go towards profitability. So some basic corrective measures had to be taken, part of which was to reduce the number of titles that we were printing, which is again completely counterintuitive, right? If you are in any other business and you are growing and you are putting out more, then the basic idea is that you should put out even more, right? Particularly in the internet, that's what you would do. But that does not work in a physical retail based model. Take any bookshop that is available in Tamil Nadu. It will be mostly a 200 square feet little box. How many titles can he actually stock there and sell? Let's say 3000 titles. It's all that you can do. And if I put out, you know, I have 2000 titles myself, and I am bringing out another 300 to 400 every year, what would the seller do? He cannot stock all my titles. So he will simply let go of all my titles and will only have about, at best, 200 titles. What are my top sellers? So if I come up with one more top seller, it's going to kill one of my existing previous top seller. That's all. Because he has a brand to manage, which means that he cannot have only one single company's products everywhere. He will need to have a variety. Even if they are not selling, he needs to stock a whole bunch of others' titles. Otherwise, it's not a bookshop. It will be a showroom of Kizhakku Pathippagam. If wherever you turn around, you would only see Kizhakku's books. So max he will give me is 2 racks. For 2 racks, that's all that is available to me. What is the point in coming up with all these titles? So this hit us at some point. So I said, okay, fine, we will work towards that. We'll reduce the number of titles. What do you mean by reduce? Are you going to kill all the books that we already have? We'll come to that. But at any given time, I will have my 200 to 300 titles. And I need to ensure that those are in print and those are available everywhere. And all the new books that I am coming up with, the 20, 30 new titles in an year, let's say I bring out about 50, 100 new titles, only 20 or 30 will be actually stocked by everyone, most of them. Many of these distribution outlets that we had put together won't even stock more than 50 because there's no space. I mean, in a textile shop, you put up a rack, how many titles can you actually have? 30, 40 titles. So we had to start reducing number of titles and changing the business model. Instead of giving huge credit of months, I mean, we'll say 3 months credit, which will eventually become 6 months credit. Instead, you turn everything around and say, we will give you books only for a very limited credit period. But even that, the way we did that, because it was a brilliant idea that our head of sales came up with, Manivannan, that let's introduce another layer in between our entire distribution setup, super stockist. Again, it is a FMCG model. We'll get the super stockist to buy from you for cash. Who will in turn offer a credit downstream, but restricted credit? Our team will be on the ground to ensure that the downstream will pay in time so that the super stockist actually has a great trust in your brand. So now the brand that we are talking about is not a brand just for the customer. We have to be a brand for the customer of all the things that I talked about, but we have to be a great brand for each one of our partners. the super stockists should trust us that the money that they invest, they'll get back. And that we commit by having our staff on the ground working for the super stockists to get more orders and collect the money back. What is there in it for the distributor and the dealer who was actually selling the book at 4 months credit and very liberal terms? We are changing terms. What is there in it for them? They will be very angry, right? They were angry. Many of them said, no, we will not stock your books. We will not sell your books. You used to give me 3 months credit. Now you are saying 15 days and 30 days credit. I don't want to be part of this business. Then we had to go and offer them something, which is that we will not change margins. That's all that you will be getting. Anybody who has any understanding of the FMCG market will see that. You offer credit, somebody is ready to order tons of that. And he can always, I mean, if returns are there, he'll happily return them also to you. Because whose risk is it? It's a manufacturer's risk. The moment you change it and say, no credit, and you can't return, now the responsibility is the distributor come sellers. But then they need better servicing, which is that instead of ordering 20 copies of a particular book and stocking it with you, which may or may not sell, but you are liable to sell, just order 3 copies. You sell it, sell them all today, you want 3 more copies, you will get 3 copies tomorrow. So I will increase the frequency of servicing you, and that is something that you can be happy about. Earlier, I was the only point from which I was supplying. So you have to order more, because otherwise you have this fear that the copies will vanish, or when there is a customer in your shop, you don't have enough copies. Now, I have distributors who are fed by super stockists to whom we supply books. You order any number of times and we'll keep supplying to you. Right? So we had to make all these changes, and that started working. Today, that has resulted in a slight shrinkage of our business, but it is stable business. The brand actually works still, because all the brand quality that we are talking about, we have already established. All the things that we talk about in terms of longevity, we have been there. Now it's our second decade. Variety, we have the entire range available. I mean, the end reader is not going to read more than 10-20 books. There are people who come to me happily and say, I have bought every book that you have published. I have a library of 30 titles. 30 I publish in less than a month's time. Okay? But in his mind, the reader thinks that he has bought all my books. I'm quite happy. I don't go and fight with him saying, no, I have 2,000 titles. You have bought only a small fraction of it. No. If he feels that he actually has all my books, I'm quite happy. I'll encourage him. So the readers are happy. On quality, we give them one quality assurance. You can buy our book anywhere. If you find that a certain page is slightly torn, I mean, we have fairly strict quality guidelines. In our warehouse, every copy is actually checked before it is taken into our racks. From the printer, whatever comes, we check every copy, right? But even then, there are mistakes. Some pages are printed in the wrong side, or when during the binding, it's done wrongly. Same form is repeated and certain pages are missing. These do happen. The percentage will be very low for us compared to anybody else, but it is there. It is not zero. So what we do is that even lower down people in our office are authorized, no questions asked, change. So I have, you know, somebody from the US calls and says, I bought this book in India, but few pages are missing. What do I do now? The book costs 100 rupees. Shipping to US costs 800 rupees. We ask them the address. No questions asked. A copy is sent. A checked copy is sent. So what we made out of that book was probably 20 rupees. What we are spending to replace that book is nearly 1,000 rupees, but it is worth it, because that person will never let go of our brand, because with us, he knows that his money is guaranteed. They will ask many times, what do I do with the book that I have? Do whatever it is. You throw the book, you give it to somebody else. A page is torn. I don't want you to get a feeling that, you know, you have been cheated somehow. You don't have to produce bill. Who else could have sold this book to you? Only one of my distributor, from whom I have already collected the money. So why worry about which bill, what, etc.? Just give a copy immediately. Right? That's a very important value that we have driven. Similarly, never argue with your customer. The customer comes, fights with you for totally reasons not under your control. Apologize first for no reason. Just say apologies. Sorry, I'm sorry. How can I solve your problem? And then work towards solving the problem. Okay. So these are some of the things that we have undertaken. And from there on, we moved into the next idea. We have been struggling to sell our books because distribution out there, the distribution infrastructure is not what it should be. So then we decided, why not become a distributor ourselves? That was also one of the mistakes, I'd say. We actually wanted to transform book distribution. So we said, there's this huge setup that we already have, taking our books to bookshops and other places. Why don't we make this infrastructure available to any publisher? We made it available to few publishers who used our platform, grew, but did not play by the rules. Okay? Because basically, a lot of short-term thinking. Right? So we work with somebody, let us say, I will not name any names because we are not praising anybody here. So there is this brand which came to us, and they had, they are not even based out of Tamil Nadu. And they were translating a set of books into Tamil, and they wanted somebody to help them. We agreed. We took the books to all the places that we were there. But then they appointed their own staff, who would go and sell the books to all the shops that we were taking at higher margin. So there was no point in anybody buying it from us. And we will not change the margins because we were applying that across all our books. So if we give to a shop at 30%, whether it is my book or somebody's book, I will only give it at 30% and no more, no less. But someone who has no infrastructure and wants to increase his penetration can offer it at 40%, 50%. So we went back to them and said, if you are changing these basic rules, we cannot distribute your books. Two, three other brands also, we did very well. We took them, we increased their presence substantially. But always there were problems like this. So we decided to completely kill the distribution business. And we said, we will only distribute and sell our own books, not anybody's books from a distribution point of view. But then we said, why not try retail? Distribution, there is a problem because we are only a middleman. Retail is different. I will procure books from every single publisher and sell it to the end customer. So that was a brand that we built called Dial for Books. Okay. We started initially with selling books online. Online book sales, even now, has not grown to, for the Indian language books, has not grown to what it should be. Offline business is still substantially large, huge. So we were selling online books, and then we figured out that there was a problem. Not everybody was online, not everybody had a credit card, and even those who had credit cards and net banking were afraid of buying things online, because you keep reading news about credit card fraud, etc. And it's not really a problem, but you can't change people's perception and opinion overnight. So then we started offering books through phone. We came up with a number. People could call that number, ask for a book. We will get the book, procure it, pack it, send it to them. How do we collect money? Two ways. We give them our account, they can transfer money. which is really a painful process, or use PPP kind of a model. That is when we actually discovered post office, and our business today with post office is quite substantial. So much so that we have priority relationship with Mylapore post office, where we can, we have a separate account, we have some almost sort of a prepaid kind of a model, we have our money into their account, and they start deducting from there and we keep replenishing that. We can bulk book things, we send substantial quantity of books through VPP, and it is one government setup we are very, very happy to work with actually. So we added, along with internet, book sales through phones. Then we had shops. In the shops, we have had multiple experiences, a lot of negative and some positive. We started setting up exclusive Kiraku showrooms, where people could walk in and buy just Kiraku books alone. About 7-8 places we set it up across, franchised out with one of our distributors. But it did not yield the kind of monthly sales which was actually paying even for the basic cost. So we completely closed down all of that. But multi-book bookshop, like what we are talking about now, this Dial for Books kind of a model, a physical bookshop just about breaks even. This is one of the reasons why no new bookshops are actually set up. To make book sales really work is extremely difficult. Extremely difficult. It calls for phenomenal understanding of this market, lot of data, extraordinary level of data analytics. We are talking about analytics, AI, and all the fancy terms. You need them to really figure out what sells, why you should stock more of it. It's beyond the capability of most booksellers. Physical bookstore, the sales is shrinking. Slowly they are moving to online. Yet, we've got to figure out ways in order to survive. We have to sell books online. We have to also sell books offline. That's the kind of a challenge that we are facing. Then we started moving into every conceivable format. We've created audiobooks. We are probably the only publisher to have created audiobooks. We have nearly 100 titles. But that was another failure model. We were putting them out in CDs. And now CDs are all gone, but they'll come back again, because very soon we will have our ebooks through a Google app, which their Google Play Store app is also going to give you ebooks. They have already started, I think. So we have just signed the contract. So all our books are going to be available there, and even more will happen. So that's just now that you have bandwidth and you have your phone, touch, select a book, buy, and start listening to that immediately. E-book, particularly through Kindle, we are growing. It's still tiny, but we are really growing there. And 5 years down the line, we don't know exactly the shape of how this whole book space is going to be. Do you want to read? Do you want to listen to them? Do you want to read online? Do you want to read offline in the printed format? I don't know. Whatever is going to be there, we will be there. Two major points that I have, this and the next slide, and that's the end of it. We don't think of anybody as a competitor, really. We are ready to work with anyone. We work with all English publishers so that we can pick up rights from them and translate the books, English books into Tamil. We would like to work with publishers in any of the language markets. We work with some Hindi publishers, some Kannada publishers, some Malayalam publishers, Marathi and Gujarati publishers, where we try to see if we can create market for Tamil books by getting them published into, translated and published into their markets. We would like to work with electronic book distributors of all kinds, physical book distributors of all kinds. If somebody is there in the space of book selling, we are ready to figure out. I mean, we don't know what we can do with them, but we are willing to listen and we are willing to propose. So this is one key point that we have. People who have fought with us, people who have said, we will never work with you. We don't have any ego. If they come back tomorrow
or even if they don't come back, we go to them saying, you know, I have a new idea, I would like to work with you. Yes, I know we have had a lot of difficulties, but that's okay. Now, if this new idea works with you, let's go and do that. We have, I mean, so many partners, life can get really tough with some of them, I mean, maybe because of us or because of them, but it has never really resulted in, you know, really breaking relationships with them. We invariably will go back. Now, this is company DNA. I'm not talking about one person or another person. You ask any of our salespeople, anybody in the business development side, this is the way we want to work. We want to work with everyone. We have fought with authors. People who have said they will never work with us will come back and work with us. We, as I said, we have no ego. We want to work with everyone all the time. The last slide is fight. We are working in an extremely difficult area, a tiny market. I am not here saying that, you know, we have done fantastic things in a huge, you know, growing, you know, something which is going to be seen by everybody. No. We are a tiny company in an extremely tiny market. I don't even know whether it will exist after a few years, because today people seem to think that they can get everything they want from Facebook and WhatsApp. You can't. That's my understanding. But I don't know what people really think. But this is such a tiny area, we have decided that we will fight, we will stay on, and we will keep coming up with new ideas. For example, we were the pioneers in making use of print-on-demand digital printing. Today, most of the books we are selling by sheer numbers, they are short print run digital books. A lot of people joked about it, saying, no, that doesn't work. Today, every publisher is using that. E-book, even now people are writing in articles in newspapers and magazines that, oh, e-book is not going to work. There is nothing like a physical book. You can touch, feel. All these romantic ideas just don't work. Because new generation of readers decide what this whole area is going to be. Old people are going to die. I'll die. But I want this brand to succeed. Now, I cannot be dogmatic and say, no, this is the way it has to be because I think so. That's complete nonsense. Right? We will keep changing. The brand will remain. What we are, you know, pushing under that, the values will remain. I have to give reading material to you in a manner that is enjoyable. It should educate you, it should make you think, it should entertain you, that's it. And it should be, I'm not talking about little bits of articles. It's something which is long, detailed, in-depth, right? Now, whatever format through which I can give that to you, I will give that. Now, in the process, whatever technology I have to follow, I'll follow that. In fact, before we started working with Amazon for the Kindle platform, we spent tens of lakh of rupees building an e-distribution platform of our own. And the day Kindle launched, we just killed that. There is no way you can compete with Kindle. We just simply gave all of that away, signed a deal with Kindle, and moved all our books into the new platform after losing a lot of money. That's okay. That's a learning. How did it help us? Because only we could talk to Amazon in a language that even they didn't really understand. I mean, how do you create language books? Today, Amazon consults with us. We give them ideas in terms of how to make that work because we had spent so much time trying to do all those things. When we talk of, say, audiobooks, Google wants to talk to us first. I mean, we are tiny, I agree. But in Tamil or in the regional language publishing, any regional language, we are way ahead of the game. But we recognize that we are tiny, we are reaching very few people, but to those book readers, we have built a brand. But that's through fighting and constant innovation. Question?